Governor wrote to me at Kerido Lu of Ondo State accuses Kaduna State Governor Nasser El-Rufai of exporting banditry to the South. And 2023 Southern Presidency is sacrosanct, Afeni Ferrier says, supporting Southern governors. This is Plus Politics, and I am Mary Anacol. The Ondo State Governor Rotimi Akeredolu has berated his counterpart in Kaduna State, Malam Nasser El-Rufai, over the latest comment on anti-grazing law. Well, El-Rufai had described the anti-open grazing laws being signed by some southern governors as unrealistic. However, Akeredolu in a statement said such a statement should have not come from a leader. He reiterated that the anti-open grazing law, especially in Ondo State, had come to stay. He said that if truly Governor El-Rufai made these statements, then it means that he's struggling hard to export banditry to the South. Well, joining us to discuss this is Thompson Okorotie. He is the Deputy National Chairman of PANDEF. And we also have Chrissy Tamanola. He is a legal practitioner. Thank you very much, Ms. Tamanola, for joining us.
Thank you very much. Apologies for the inconveniences due to power failure and the rest of that. Happy to be here.
All right. So it's interesting that we are seeing this war of words between two governors, one in the north and one in the south. And let's also, you know, cast our minds back to the fact that southern governors across party lines had taken a position on open grazing in the southern parts of the country because of the issue of banditry. Now, we also have seen reactions coming from other governors in the north saying that it is a political conspiracy of sorts. And here we are again, Governor Akeredolu and Governor El-Rufai having this back and forth. But now let's not also forget that we've seen one southern governor who has taken a step back and cancelled, or rather unbanned, open grazing in his state, and that's the Imo State governor. Which means that he's backpedaled, and so open grazing can happen in his state. But let's look at the basis of this matter. A law is a law, obviously, and open grazing is a business of sorts. And if a state is saying that this is what they want, why should that be a problem? And do you think this is politically motivated in the first instance?
Well, first and foremost, let me commend our democracy for this. By background, Akeredolu and the governor of Kaduna State, El-Rufai, are both APC governors. And that the two of them can have a divergent views is good for our democracy. It's not being drawn on party lines. Having said that, it's imperative for us to know that if we acknowledge the fact that we are a federation, it means that the varying states must definitely all have powers to express their goodwill, express their opinion as they believe it. I mean, as practiced all over the world. I mean, Los Angeles, I mean, I beg your pardon, one state in America will take a decision, and it will differ from that of that opinion from another state in America. And yet the presidency is not going to sound otherwise about it. By the Nigerian constitution, the states have powers to make laws that are suitable to them. The presidency cannot impose its own opinion, let alone El-Rufai making counter. I mean, the decisions have been taken from the south. I mean, not only south, across the various states in Nigeria previously up till now, that open grazing is anti-people. And to that extent, for goodness sake, why can't you respect the opinions of the various governors and the states? Let me stop there.
Mr. Tamanola, I'm curious because the truth is, from time, I mean, since I was born, I've always seen nomads, I've seen these cattle rearers move from one place to the other. Migration is in their DNA. Now, in 2021, bandits have come under the guise of cattle rearers, and has caused a security issue for us. Normally, one would ask that, you know, let's say Mieti Ala deal with the issue by trying to stay off the road so that we can catch those people who are masquerading as, you know, cattle rearers in the guise of bandits. But telling these people not to move around the country, how easy do we think that this is going to be? Because El Rufai is making a case that it's not something that can happen overnight, but that the governors are making a law that is unimplementable. And he also said that they're politicizing. And that's why I asked you at the beginning, do you think that this issue has a political undertone? Is it that the South is trying to take advantage of the situation that is happening in the Northwest to, you know, push these business people away?
The answer is absolutely no. And the basis of it is this. Look, 2021 is not 1899. 2021 is certainly not 1960, nor even 1970. And let me tell you something. Up till shortly before 1999, Nigerians lived together irrespective of their political, social, religious belief without any form of divide, without any form of bias. But unfortunately, I'm not sure that the present day administration, not necessarily whether it is APC or PDP, I'm not sure the present administrations are helping in relation to building trust amongst, not just among the federating states, but amongst the people. I mean, today we have intermarriages between North and South, between Christians and Muslims and whatsoever. And why can't it be? There is, under normal circumstances and ordinarily, there is nothing wrong that a cattle rearer is moving from the North to South. But in the event that he moves from North to South and he commits some vices, he breaches some etiquette, what are the laws and what are the realities on ground? What are the evidences to show that such set of people have been brought to book while you are bringing to book other people from maybe from the east, from the southern, the western region, regarding coal and so on? Look at what is happening in the eastern region regarding Nnamdi Kanu. How many people in the north will you be able to say? While some, when you say cattle rearers, while you say talk about this set of people, you cannot generalize. You can't form an opinion to say that all cattle rearers are evil men. But it is definitely true that some cattle rearers definitely are evil men. And of course, where these have been found culpable, what are the evidences? I mean, for goodness sake, in River State here in Port Harcourt, you go to the Agri Road, you go to Elele, you go to, these are settlements of where you see outside people or the Fulanis or the cattle rearers and the rest of that. But while you come, do you acknowledge that the host community is also entitled to having an expression in terms of how they feel about you? Can we also go in same manner to the north and feel at home without being threatened and whatsoever? These are the issues. And I think that the presidency can do a lot more by seeking, you know, appealing to the consciences of the various governors and through the governors to the people. What the president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, who came by democratic principles, ought to do in this situation is not to force himself to choke the governors and the states and whatsoever, but to give an impression that he's a father not just to the north, but to all the federating states.
Okay.
At the moment, I'm not sure that I'm seeing that speaking.
I mean, I, as much as it's interesting that the president wades into the matter, state governors themselves have to also appeal to each other's consciences. But let me go to what Governor El Rufai has said recently. He did say that his state has embarked on a 10 billion naira cattle ranch project to centralize all herders in his state. He's also talked about the fact that the Central Bank of Nigeria was supporting the state with about 7.5 billion naira for the success of that project. So they are actually going to build some ranching in Kaduna State. Now, in response to that, of course, Governor Akeredolu is saying, well, if you are doing this in your state, why are you kicking against the fact that we are one way or the other trying to get these people to go into ranching. Now, I'd like to quickly go to what Governor Akeredolu said. I'd like to just quote him directly. He said, firstly, there is no wisdom in condemning or banning open grazing, prohibiting the inter-border movement of cattle in the north, including Kaduna, with accompanying disapproval of a law that gives bite to same in another part of the country. Then he goes ahead to say, perhaps it's apt to state clearly that the likes of El Rufai are already in a hysteric mode of escalating and indeed externalizing banditry, especially as the military onslaught against criminal elements and other terror variants suffices in the north. I'm trying to understand how and why a governor like El Rufai will be escalating or trying to export banditry to the south. Do you not think that that statement was a bit too sensitive in terms of, you know, somewhat saying that maybe Governor El Rufai is trying to push banditry to the, down to the south?
Well, the reality is the reality, and you can't shy away from it. That's what El Rufai has stated. And to an extent, I sympathize with him. I sympathize with him because it appears he is speaking out of frustration. Right now, definitely, as far as Kaduna State is concerned, El Rufai is doing more than he can. And I can assure you, there is a great amount of insecurity in that particular place. But having said that, El Rufai should also appreciate that the rest of the people, we are citizens of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, and that we are a state. And that if we are a state, we also have the responsibility to take our destinies into our hands. That a governor decides that, okay, I mean, we are not accepting this order, we do not yet see it to, this way, does not mean that it will remain like that tomorrow. Now, having said that, the federal government gave you 10 billion. Let the federal government extend the 10 billion to the rest of the federating states now, including and particularly River State, where I belong. And let's see the reaction of our governor. Just by example now, several states were given the privilege listed for purpose of taking overseas loan and whatsoever. River State was excluded. What impression are you trying to give? And of course, when it comes to that, and somebody will say that.
But what if states like River State can actually afford to fund itself? River State is the second largest revenue received from, you know, the state coffers every month. They get almost the second largest, if I'm not mistaken, after Lagos. So, I mean, why would they want to be giving them loans? And I'm not saying that the River State does not qualify for a loan, but maybe the states who are being given priority are states that are struggling. Have you thought about that?
35 states, including Abuja, were given listed as exclusive of a River State. So if you think that is because we are self-sufficient, state it so. Be direct about it. Do not go about it, by way of innuendo. Be state it categorically that this is the reason. But don't do so because that is Lagos State, not richer than River State. Why are they all enlisted? But that's not the issue we are talking about now. The most important thing is presidency because we entrusted you to have great amount of wisdom. We entrusted you with great amount of excellence, candor in relation to governance, in relation to administration, in relation to cohesiveness. Well, Nigeria is a great country and we are not about to scatter. We also definitely are looking forward to a presidency that is going to ensure that we will not only scatter, but we are seen not to scatter. These things are definitely not good elements in any particular form.
Finally, let me just quickly, because we're almost out of time. Why do you think that the Imo State governor backpedaled on the issue of open grazing? And let's not also forget that Imo State has had its fair share of, you know, internal problems, even though they're not mostly related to banditry, but there might be also pockets of violence, you know, related to other things. Why do you think the governor decided to push back on it after he had said yes?
I can tell you clearly it's political. Imo State governor, I can tell you boldly that, look, you may be in APC, but for goodness sake, go beyond the party lines. I mean, show to the whole world that in taking your decisions that you are people-oriented, I'm not sure that Imo State Governor has reflected that. Thank you.
Well, I want to say thank you, Barrister Kristi Tamunola is a lawyer. Thank you so much for being part of the conversation. We appreciate it.
I'll always be here wherever you want me. God bless you.
All right. Well, thank you all for staying with us. We'll take a quick break now. When we return, we discuss our Fennifer's stand on Southern presidents. We'll take a short break.